We are privileged to have young South Sudanese with us here in the studio who are going to take us through a program, and this program is called Polish Humanitarian Action, and they work here in South Sudan in many parts of the country, and they are going to tell us more. My guest, you are most welcome in the studio.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're most welcome, and it's nice having you, listener. As always, this is Humanitarian Perspective, and I'm going to be the one taking you through the program every Monday, coming from 2 to 3 p.m., and I hope you'll be joining me in the program, discussing through our lines, which is telephone lines, live on air, is 0912062432, and the other line is 0912062439, and you'll be live in the program. Let me give my guests a chance to introduce themselves. You're very most welcome. Can I start from this side?
Yeah, thank you so much, Regina. I am, dear listeners, I'm Emmanuel Lumaya. I work for Polish Humanitarian Action as a senior emergency shelter and NFI officer.
Okay, you're most welcome.
Thank you, Regina.
Okay, thank you, Regina, and all the listeners of Radio Miraya. Mm-hmm. I'm called Moga Emmanuel. I work in the same organization, Police Humanitarian Action, as Senior Hygiene and Sanitation Officer.
Okay. It's nice having you guest here in the studio. Maybe I can start with Moga. If you could give us a highlight, tell us when was this organization founded and what is it, its activities, actually.
Okay. Thank you very much. First, to begin with, I want to aware our listeners. They might be surprised that we are South Sudanese, and they might think that this organization we are coming to talk about is from South Sudan. No. Mm. This is an international organization from Poland, and it was formed in 1992 back in Poland, and it started its humanitarian work in South Sudan in 2006. Mm-hmm. It was based in Jongole, not until when the crisis broke out in 2013, its headquarters was relocated to Juba. So we are working with it, and that's why we are here. Not that people should have, it's a surprise sometimes when people see South Sudanese talking and coming to represent an international organization.
Yes.
They might think we are coming to represent a South Sudanese-based organization.
Oh, yeah.
No,
or local society,
yes,
or something.
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah. This is an international organization, and we hold that capacity. Mm.
And we are also glad that the organizations here in South Sudan, the UN agencies and the international organizations, and it is a true that they employ South Sudanese, and that's why you are also working there with them. Yeah,
absolutely, you're right,
so,
Regina.
Uh-huh.
Yes, under my capacity, with what Moga has just said, my colleague here, this organization really has given South Sudanese the opportunity to explore as much as they can according to their capacity. If you portray capacity, you are given the right to
the skills,
exactly the skills.
Yeah,
you're well skilled. They really appreciate what is supposed to be appreciated.
Yeah, and actually, you know, the international NGOs say that, especially in the fields,
yes,
is the South Sudanese working with the people on the ground, and they are the one who know the needs of the people,
exactly,
on the ground.
Exactly.
So in your capacity, what you are doing, what exactly do you do to support the people of South Sudan in the fields where you work?
Particularly for me, I work for the NFI and Emergency Shelter Department. I actually head it. Here we respond to emergencies because we are part of the emergency response team, one of the only five organizations in the entire South Sudan who have mobile teams who respond to emergencies anywhere among the 10 states.
Okay.
So particularly in the emergency response team, we respond to needs, particularly for non-food items, as NFI stands. There are people who, when crisis comes in or it's disaster, we respond to them to give them life-saving materials or life-saving items.
When you talk to life-saving item, non-food items,
exactly.
What exactly could you mention, two or three of it?
The content of them, we give them blankets.
Okay.
We have mosquito nets that prevent them from mosquitoes. And then automatically we are could be contributing to the reduction of malarial cases. Mm. And then we also give them sleeping mats. We give them kitchen sets, like to help them establish themselves. No, because usually after emergencies, people lose all their household belongings. Mm-hmm. So we rush in to give them these household belongings that can help them to settle in within the shortest period mm-hmm. possible. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you so much for that explanation. And it's nice having that. I have Emmanuel. All of them are Emmanuels here. But at least the second names can make them the difference. And they are all South Sudanese. They work with these organizations. And if you have a question that you would like to ask them what they do on the ground, and you do want a clarification, you'll be able to call them there later on. And tell us a bit in your work. What challenges do you face?
Of course, in most cases, people say there are challenges, but the only major challenge that I think will not only apply to our organization or the organization for which we work, because for us, we work in the most affected areas of South Sudan, and in this case, these are remote areas. The challenge that we face is lack of accessibility. I mean, logistically, some of the areas are hard to reach. It means we will have to access it through use of maybe air transport, which sometimes is a challenge. And sometimes you might find that there are needs in the area. People are suffering, but there is no possibility of getting into such areas. Mm. Not even any means of transporting any kind of humanitarian assistance, be it the NFIs as mentioned, whatsoever kind of help that you need to give.
So how do you get the materials across?
In most cases, we have been liaising with the logistic cluster, which is headed by World Food Program. They have been so much supportive. And of course, not forgetting our donors who have been behind us always. Sometimes we charter air flights, and where the emergency or the affected population lies within the corridors where there's transport means, we also use road transport.
You are also a senior hygiene promotion officer. Yeah. What do you exactly do with the people, or how do you promote that hygiene?
Okay, as mentioned by my colleague, we majorly respond to emergencies, and we are in the emergency response teams. Quickly, I want to mention that in this emergency response team, we have three sectors: the non-food item sector, the hygiene promotion sector, and the waste technical sector. We provide basic hygiene promotion, behavior change in terms of hygiene practices. We also do provide trainings for pump mechanics so that they'll be able to repair water points that might have broken down. As we know, water is life, and that means we also have to work very hard to ensure people drink safe water. We also do provide capacity building to local community-based leaders, women groups, and also provide capacity building to institutions, for example, teach schools and health facilities.
Lumaya, you have something you want to add in your field?
Yes, particularly, it will not be as much as Moga has just put it. We do trainings for communities, especially when emergency strikes and they've moved away, let me say, in terms of floods. Now, when floods have struck and all
that's
your...
That's when there's heavy rains.
Exactly, during the heavy rains. If you're going to move to an upland where your homes have been destroyed by floods, what we do, it's like we also, as a preparation phase, we give the community a simple trainings on how to be able to construct robust structures. Like when we take for them plastic sheets on ground, how are they going to be able to erect simple shelters for them to cope up with the situation on a drier area before putting up a permanent structure. So this is again a one kind of training that we've just started, and we will be building the community's capacity to be able to respond to that kind of scenario when it happens. Before we could come in to give them training, community should be having people who can respond to that earlier enough among themselves.
So how does the community respond to your services? What is the feedback?
Absolutely, it's overwhelming. In all the areas we've gone to, in Northern Jongole, in Unity, particularly, because these are states whereby most emergencies occur, the response has been very positive, because some of these items communities have not been familiar with. And because of access reasons, we always train the communities, our own people, to be able to use these materials sustainably, because access is the huge problem, as Moga has put it, because some of these items, they need to be rechanged every 6 months. But because of access, they cannot. So you need to train them to be able to put something that can sustain them for over 6 months before you respond again. That is in terms where the community is settled in a robust condition, like an IDP location. But if not, if it's their homes, you make them, you train them further, even on ways of how they can prevent floods. You also train them, you talk to them on ways.
Let me also ask you,
yes,
as you are the senior officer for non-food items,
yes,
how do you make sure that these items go to the needy directly? Because at times it happened that the things taken needed for vulnerable people,
yes,
it ended up not getting to the right people.
Particularly, we go on ground as a team. When we get information, usually this coordination happens at UN OCHA, where all this information is done, is coordinated among all the humanitarian agencies. So when the need appears, or when the need is clear, we go on ground to assess the needs of this community, of these people. Team goes on ground, does assessment of the needs, and recommendations are made basing on the needs identified by the team. And then the team does verification and registration of the targeted beneficiaries. So after registering them, they are issued tokens, or if tokens are not issued, at least you have a criteria in place that registration is done only
contain your name and
exactly your name and family hall size, and then the items also that are given, particularly that take care of the women needs, as well as part of the entire non-food items. So that criteria we put in place, it's done orderly, and then we fall back to Juba, and then prepositioning of these items is done through, as my colleague has put it, with the logistics cluster. If the donor provision allows us, then we charter flights to the locations, and then these items, and then the team makes sure that these items are distributed before the team comes out of the field. So we don't leave these items in the hands of the community to do it by themselves. We go on ground and make sure that the community is satisfied with the service offered to them. And then
do you sometimes receive complaint, maybe somebody has not received something or something like that?
Yes, particularly we do get sometimes someone comes and tells us that we were not there during the registration. And usually items are prepositioned, particularly for people who are
there.
Who are there at that time. So those complaints are taken up. Of course, we do consider them when the items are still there during distribution, because we put contingency items that go with us. So when the contingency items are there, and then for those special cases, it's when we can verify through the community leaders. Are these people really, are they part of that community? Because sometimes also people from further communities do come and join these other communities, but we usually tell them all the other communities where their needs, they'll be responded from their own.
Their
particular
location.
Locations, yes. So we do verify that through the leaders.
Okay, thank you for that elaboration. And Moga, in your organization, if you could tell us the priorities that the organization is actually focusing on, much is, what is it?
Okay, we have two major priorities. One is the non-food items. Two is the WASH component. WASH means water, sanitation, and hygiene. Yeah, those are the two major components for which we are known of. And we, in all our projects and all the locations where we work, those are the only priorities. They are the only things we do, and they are our priorities as well.
Yeah. Other things comes by the way or something like that?
Not really, except that we incorporate cross-cutting issues like gender, protection, and environmental management into the WASH and NFI component of our activities.
So apart from transporting the non-food items or other items to the field in order to do the services properly, what other humanitarian challenges that also face you like any other humanitarian?
There are no much other challenges that we face apart from the accessibility. Maybe the only challenge that people always talk about is maybe the issue of donors. This is becoming a general situation in South Sudan, but we have been having stable donors who have been funding us throughout. To mention a few, we have been having ECHO funding us throughout. CHF, Common Humanitarian Fund, has also been funding us. Sometimes RRF, Rapid Response Fund, has also been supporting us. And we also have been getting some funding from GIZ. So at the moment, beside the they talk about the funding gap, we have still not realized so many challenges. Mm. Yes.
Okay. So at the moment, your fund is in place. You have no problem, because there are other international NGOs at times, they have the limited funds and say, for the time being, our work will stop or something like that. Do you want to add?
I'm not saying maybe we are not having any funding gap, but what I'm saying is we have not yet realized.
Okay. Mm.
However, our project, the one we are having now, is coming towards an end. But I don't want to say we have run out of funding, because still to some days we have a funding.
Mm.
But what comes next is what we are going to see.
Okay.
Yes.
So there is going to an end. How much fun was there to run these activities or projects? Could you have any clue?
Okay, I cannot quote exactly, but I cannot quote exactly the figures, but we have been having enough funding to ensure that we handle and run successfully the emergencies that occur.
Mm.
Yes.
Okay. Lumaya, do you have something that maybe you look smiling if there's anything that you'd want to add?
I'm a bit a happy person always, but my colleague has really put it. We had sufficient funding from ECHO, particularly because that's our major donor.
Mm.
That is the European Commission for Humanitarian Aid and Civil Protection.
Mm.
That department has been overwhelming for us in the last over 4 years now.
Okay.
Funding has been sufficient, and though coming to an end, the hope is obviously they've been standing with us.
Mm.
So the funding has been sufficient that we were able to charter boats, to hire boats in locations that we cannot reach by air or by land. We used to go on water as well. We were able to charter a number of flights for staffs and the items to go to the field. So we're able to purchase enough spare parts for for borehole rehabilitation and those activities. So the funding has been sufficient.
Okay. And even if the funding is coming to an end, as you put it, and we hope still your donors are there standing with you, because the need in South Sudan is still great.
It's still great, yes.
Yeah. Listener, you are still listening to Humanitarian Perspective with me, Regina Gonle. And today we have an international NGO, and we have South Sudanese who are employed there, and they are the one running the activities there on the field. And we are privileged to have them so that they can explain to us the activities of this organization. And this organization is Polish Humanitarian Action, and they are here with us to tell us more of their activities. And if you have any question you would like them to clarify, whether you know this organization or you don't know it, or there are other things that you would like them to clarify, they are here and ready to answer your questions. And our lines, 0912062432. The other line is 0912062439, and you'll be live in the program. Song coming to you from Chris Brown, Brown Skin Girl, and you are still listening to Humanitarian Perspective with me, Regina Gonle, taking you through the program. And I have guests here with me in the studio. We have South Sudanese who are staffs of Polish Humanitarian Action, and they are here with me in the studio, and they work across South Sudan, and they are telling us more about the project that they do and the whole what the run of the organization is here in South Sudan. And if you have a question, you can ask them your question and ask them what they do here in the South Sudan. This is an international NGO and South Sudanese who are here with me in the studio representing the organization. Give us your thought and ask a question. Hello, Radio Mira.
Hello.
Marhab.
Yes, Tommy.
Tamam, Kevin, brother.
Monut, Georgie.
Monut, welcome. Kevita, Monut.
Tamam, kusenda tayebe le kullu ya kwana jinubil baki mwara eva marijina gorle ma defna fisidio kullu ya kwana jinub Sudan ulwilaya ni judad walbi tayeba msilo le defna fisidio marijina marijina gorle
fada
yani walbi tayeba msilo defna fisidio fi ajad bitaas elhali ya fi dola ya fi wilaya ya fi jiran zato yani ana bitmana yani fi ugugistan nesmabua ugugistan hello ugugistan doro shino ya fi dola ya fi meltani ya fi bedi ya fi malati
Mwani kwa anna magonu suhugu yeah. Inshan. Anna gonu skalamta humanitarian. Yani kev akil boosulu ne nas. Omu anfige staka
lina. Naam, ayma angi alo. Chan finna sabanin. Kumela red mutasira ufita anin. Yani balga akil ma jar khali. ومسكين تاني تلقاه جان وتعبان وما ياكل ياكل وفي تاني عيان وما عنده قروش وعدو يا خالي وواحد وفي تاني من ما ادري ادري امشي لحاله وشهر تعبان ومعضلات ما في
سؤالتك يا
مولاي عشان امشي لحاله وشهر وشهر تعبان ده واحد وتلقاه شتان وتعبان وما لاقي اكل ياكل يشرب يعني هل كلام زي ده اللي ضربنا في الفيديو كلام ده كيف نمرة اثنين يعني في شيء تاني يعني زي الطلبة الأطفال يعني في نشوف زي المدارس طبعا القراية كمان بقى قروش خالي بقى مشكلة شديد ليالنا يعني كيف يرفع جنوب السودان تلقاهم مدارس ذاته تلقاهم خدمات بتاعه ضعيف وسجلهم
Shukran Manut. Manut is talking about the people in the those sites where maybe crisis, they are vulnerable with no food, and he's also asking the challenge, you people work there in the field, about the challenge of education with those children who are vulnerable.
Particularly, I can't respond to Manut in a way that, particularly as PAH, Police Humanitarian Action, as Moga had put it, we only respond to water, sanitation and hygiene needs, and then non-food items. To the most vulnerable and to locations where people are in dire need, they have no access to even local markets to get some of these items. So we target those ones as Police Humanitarian Action. But of course, we have partners or fellow humanitarian organizations that do implement their projects, particularly in education, in food items. Yes, particularly.
So Polish Humanitarian Action, actually yes. You can also give food.
No.
The way Monut is asking about food?
No, okay. That is to WFP, World Food Program is the one dealing with food. Ours is only non-food items.
So if you found people who are vulnerable and totally had nothing, what do you do?
Usually when we go on ground and we identify that they also need, particularly for food items, for health, for education, we also do in our reports and then we share
then
with the partners.
The
yes.
People.
We share with the partners and then we tell that partners we are from this location, their needs in this particular sector. And as we don't have, we don't implement projects in that line, so please, can you go on ground? There are locations whereby we go different organizations, like over five of us doing different kind of activities. So in that kind of scenario, we also avail that kind of information. That's the importance of coordination for a humanitarian organization, whereby you coordinate your activities, you share information.
And then what does not you don't implement, you take it to the others.
Exactly. What you don't implement, you inform your colleagues in the... Yes.
Yeah, Manut, I hope you got your answer. Hello, Radio Mira.
Hello.
Hello. Welcome.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. How are you doing?
Long time. How are you, my sister?
I'm good. Long time. And your
thank
name?
Thank you very much. You are Mawut Mabora. I left from Mawut.
Mawut, welcome.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to welcome the guest to this studio. So I have a question here, Regina Gorle.
Okay.
Yeah, I think our guest, they are discussing about their organization is focused on provision of water to the people.
Yeah.
Am I clear?
Yeah, yes. Water, sanitation,
yes.
And non-food item. Yes, you are right.
Yeah, thank you. So my question is, so are you just based there in Juba or your project extends to the rest of the state in South Sudan? Because there are some people here in the village. They have no access to clean water, and also there are no other clean things. For example, people they use to defecate outside. So, what can you tell that let people improve the location in the country?
Can you tell us your location?
I will.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, welcome.
Thank you, Mabora Lek. Just to answer your question, we are based in Juba. In Juba is just an office. Our activities, we conduct them outside Juba and in Juba when there is need. To make our listeners in Mabori particular understand, we majorly work in emergencies. with the most vulnerable communities. By this we mean, one, we work with people who are displaced, meaning the IDPs, and maybe people who are affected by disasters, give example of flooding, and also people who are affected perhaps by conflict and they will have to relocate or they lost most of their items. Not that, for example, maybe nothing has happened in a place and people are just settling in a normal circumstance and we go there. We don't work in that way. There are other agencies that do that kind. For us, we work where people are affected at least by some circumstance beyond their control. This is where we intervene. In most places, we have worked almost, let me say, in the previous 10 states, if I should use, if I'm wrong, in the 10 states that used to exist, we have worked almost in, if I'm not mistaken, 7 or 6 of the states. Yes, in different counties, different villages, different payams, different bombers. We are only based in Juba. In Juba is an office. And we have several coordination offices and other locations outside Juba.
So in short, you just want to tell him that you are not going when there is no situation that you need to cater for, like that emergency that you are talking about, so that he understands.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Mabor, I hope you get your answer. Hello, Radio Mira.
Hello, Regina Bolle.
Fadal, Kev.
Tamam.
I'm
speaking to Marco Dengadel from Nyamlel.
Marco from Nyamlel. Welcome, Marco.
Thank you very much. So, when I welcome the guest in the studio, but my question goes like this. As Mobior has stated it already, so here I am here in the village. So, really, people are in need of the help for something like hygiene, because most of our people here, they are using wells, which was used last time when there was no organization. Still people are using wells now to get some water. So, and some people drink on the stream. So, I'm asking the guests in the studio, what are the plans to reach all the beneficiaries who are people who need help in South Sudan? What are your plans of covering the whole South Sudan?
They say their services is not just going around South Sudan states, but it's in an emergency situation. If area people are displaced, then they come in or something like that. Could you
clarify your question? They come in the emergency situation.
Exactly.
When people are crowded and they have no latrines, they have no okay.
Yes.
Now I can get the point anyway, but let them answer me if possible.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you
so much. Thank you, Marco.
Thank you so much, Marco, from Nyamulel. I think it's because of the current situation that we are responding in that. We also do have those kind of projects that are in particular locations, like our project in Pibor only takes care of a situation like this one, whereby we have a separate team that has static presence in one particular location, and in Pibor we just drilled about 15 boreholes.
Wow.
Yes, in locations like those ones. And then we have one in Ayod, in Jech. Particularly, we have a project which is being funded by CHF. They are rehabilitating boreholes, training pump mechanics, and trying to train the communities on household level water treatment, whereby you are trained on how to treat your water if your immediate source is fetching from a river or from a stream. You are trained on how to do treatment at household levels, and some we do distribute as well those water treatment, water purifying.
You distribute them also?
Yeah, we do. Okay. We do as well. Anything to do with water, we really do it. And even testing the quality of the water we do water quality analysis, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So with time, we will get to those locations when our donor base has expanded.
No problem. Slow and sure. Hello, Radio Mirai. Hello.
Hello, Radio Mirai.
Yes, hi.
Yes, how are you?
I'm fine. How about you? Your name and where you're calling from?
I'm very fine. This is a call from Gorial State.
Okay, a call. Yes, welcome.
Yes, I have something like 2 questions here, my dear sister.
Go ahead.
So I want to ask these two guys, two guys in the studio, I want to know how long are they working in South Sudan up to this time? That's one. Second, if they are working in South Sudan, do they have roles so that they can maintain public health and also people of South Sudan to be in good environment? Like for instance, they have mentioned that they are working in crowded areas. Those who have been displaced, so they are working there. But are they working, are they serving as the volunteers, those who are working with them, are they working as volunteers or they are working
or
as they are
employed? Thank you.
Okay,
to answer you straight away, as I mentioned from the beginning, in South Sudan, Policy Humanitarian Action started its work in 2006, meaning it's 10 years now. And about if we have the interest to promote public health, yes, I said from the beginning, our priorities are WAS and NFI.
Mm.
So he asked whether we are working as volunteers or we are employees. We
actually,
are both.
Maybe he also want to know
yes.
if you people are.
We are both.
Yeah.
Oh, we are both employees and volunteers.
Okay. So you are both.
Why I'm saying that is, we have the will. Even outside our office work, we also do the same because we want to lead exemplary life. And besides us as the employees, we also do go to the communities and provide trainings. We train our local capacity to ensure that when the NGO phase out from the location.
Mm-hmm.
They will still be able to sustain the activities that they got from us. We train local people, I mean people from the particular location, on hygiene promotion. We train also pump mechanics who will maintain the water points, say boreholes and wells. We also do train women groups, as I mentioned previously.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's take last caller. Hello, Radio Mira. Hello. Hello, Radio Mira.
Yes, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, welcome.
Yeah, you're speaking with Kwan Tong calling from Ye.
Kwan, from where? Ye?
From Ye, yeah.
Okay, welcome, Kwan.
Yeah, thank you so much. My question goes straight here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm asking my guest in the studio, how will someone get to know more special detail about the organizations? So, as they are based in some part of the state, like they said that they are based in Juba and in Bor and also in Bentiu. How will someone get to know? Is there something like website?
Okay.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Brief question. And the person, is it Moga? You are sorry.
Oh, okay, let me respond to that.
And then from there, you give your last word in 1 minute, and then I go to Moga.
Okay. Thank you so much, our caller from Ye. We do have a full-fledged website, even way before when we joined the organization. It has been there. We have www.pah.org.pl. That is the website. You can get information.
Maybe you want to know more about you people.
Exactly. Yeah. You can get even names of all the staffs of the South Sudan mission, the mission in Somalia, where we are in Nepal. You can get all the names of their employees on that website. There's quite a lot of information in that website. To summarize, thank you so much, Miraya, for giving us this opportunity to let our communities to know what Polish Humanitarian Action is doing in South Sudan. We will always be there for our own people. We've gone to locations that are very difficult to reach. We've gone to locations whereby you are dropped by a helicopter in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah, left
but
there.
Because with the heart for the people, you do reach to those locations.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you so much. Moga, in 1 minute.
I want to say thank you, Radio Miraya. And one thing I want to point out is... as I said from the beginning, we are South Sudanese. When people always hear of organizations coming from outside South Sudan, they think it's maybe people from the outside world. But I can assure you the South Sudanese are doing better in the humanitarian work. For example, we are this mission of Police Humanitarian Action in South Sudan has employed 70 people. And out of these 70, 62 are from South Sudan. So sometimes it is wrong to say the South Sudanese don't have capacity, because if we can man the whole of this organization and we can run it straight,
then what capacity are they talking about?
Yes. Exactly.
So people should stand up and be proud, and also those in the humanitarian agencies, they should ensure they deliver to the best to brass out some of these ideas sometimes.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much, and it's nice having you, and thank you for your time to walking into our studios and to discuss these issues of your activities on the ground. And you are doing great there with the people on the ground. As we said earlier in the discussion, you also mentioned the need is so great, and we, the South Sudanese, we know the needs of our people better, and we have to work for the betterment of this country. And thank you so much, listener. In the studio, I had Emmanuel Lumaya Sindani. He is the senior non-food item officer, and we also have Moga Emmanuel. He's the senior hygiene promotion officer, and all of them are from Polish Humanitarian Action. And thank you so much for having you.
You're welcome.
You.
Listener, we have come to the end of this program, and do catch me again next Monday. That's the other coming Monday, and for another organization that will be hosting here in the studio live on air. And I'm Regina Gorle, and the rest of the team from Radio Mira, thank you so much, and have a good time. And those who contributed in the